Well, hello everybody and a very warm welcome to the Mugello circuit for the championship decider and final round of the 2015 Euro Series by Nova. It's been a fantastic year of racing. We are now getting to the very, very sharp end of the season with the title fight between Oliver Freymuth, Michael Stangas, Frederik Blomstedt still very much up for grabs. For now though, we have got the pre-race festivities taking place on the grid as the cars are lined up and ready to go for this concluding 50-minute race of the season. Well, the first race of the weekend was claimed in dominant fashion by Frederik Blomstedt and Mark Johannes Stangas. It was Johannes Stangas who started the race and dominated in the early stages, and then Frederik Blomstedt taking over for the second phase of the race and romping clear to a very comfortable victory, aided somewhat by the demise of Pavel Lefteroff, as we'll see on the grid now. Conversations taking place with Frederik Blomstedt. He will be starting for this race too. So yes, we have problems for Pavel Lefteroff, also problems for Oliver Freymuth, which has a big bearing on the outcome of the points chase. So it meant that Luca Magnoni finished in second place in race one. Gianluca Carboni completing the podium after final corner drama. We didn't see all of it, but Luca Lorenzini suddenly slowing through that final hairpin, and that meant that Carboni was able to pick his way past him on the run towards the line. There is Luca Magnoni, who was runner-up in race one. The Netta G55 pilot did a very, very good job in the early stages of the race, where there was a ferocious fight that was going on for third place that was really very spectacular. Salvador Tinio was the driver to watch for, and Magnoni possibly could have fallen victim to some over-exuberance. He didn't and was able to persevere. The driver who will be most disappointed is this man, Pavel Lefteroff, the Lotus Evora, which dominated in Spa, dominated in Misano, ran into all sorts of bother. Eventually Lefteroff's race effectively ending with a spin into the gravel, most uncharacteristic given how impressive Lefteroff has been throughout the course of the season. There is Stefanelli, who will be taking over from Luca Lorenzini, and Stefanelli, one of the most spectacular drivers in the early stages of race one. So the grid is all but cleared, just one or two mechanics waiting for the signal to shut the door and to get the grid cleared. The cars then will be off on the green flag formation lap, and then we will be going racing for 50 minutes to bring an end to this Euro Series by Nova season. Thank you very much for joining us here in Mugello. Just a little bit of concern, is that Oliver Freymuth? As we'll have a look at the grid then, with Frederik Blomstedt lining up in pole position. Alongside him is Luca Magnoni, then Pavel Lefteroff in third, and Luca Lorenzini in fourth. Roberto Gentili, Oliver Freymuth on the third row here of Gianluca Carboni and Mark Spekervos. Away goes the pace car. There is Frederik Blomstedt stepping up into the Ginetta G55 this weekend with Marco Heller Stangas. The pair of them have been seen in the Ginetta G50 throughout much of the year, and well, a good result for Blomstedt and Heller Stangas today, and a disappointing result for Oliver Freymuth will be enough to secure the points title for the Scandinavian pairing. Field head off on to their green flag formation lap, and this is going to be their last opportunity to get a sense of the track conditions here in Mugello, see what has changed since race one, but also get a little bit of heat into their tyres. What we were seeing in race one was particularly the Ginetta G50s, those that pushed very hard in the opening stage of the race, beginning to encounter a few problems into the latter phase of the race, and drivers just be mindful not to overcut the Michelins. In particular, Roberto Gentili, we saw him there in the bright red number 7 car, having an absolutely gigantic moment just after he took over from the mid-race pit stop. If you have never seen the Euro Series by Nerve before, there is a mandatory pit stop that comes between 20 and 30 minutes, so the middle 20% of the race. That is where the strategic dimension starts to come into the fore. It's also where the race can begin to be turned on its head just a little bit. Well, this Mugello circuit, certainly for viewers in the United Kingdom, probably better known as a motorcycle racing venue, but has played host in the past to rounds of the World Endurance Championship and is an equally spectacular venue for those competing on four wheels as well as two. Undulations of the circuit through the Tuscany countryside, together with a nice wide layout, lots of high and mid-speed corners that drivers can really attack, really enjoy. As we come towards the end of this formation lap and the start of the 12th and final race of the season for the Euro Series by Nova, there is Gianluca Carboni, and Carboni, who was involved in the fight for fourth place in the early stage of yesterday's race, ran fourth really throughout much of the second half of the race, arguably was a little bit fortunate to take third place on the final lap, but at the end of the day, it is finishing that counts, and to finish first you've got to finish, as the pace car now bunches the cars up side by side. The spectators are ready for the race to get underway. And there is Frederik Blomstedt. Just move around just a little bit more, trying to get as much temperature into his Michelin tyres as possible. The black Vora, that is Pavel Lefteroff. The sky blue car is Luca Lorenzini. The orange car on the front row is Luca Magnoni. As the field roll down through the final hairpin, waiting for the lights on the gantry to change, which they are about to do any moment now. Then we are going racing for the final time this year in the Euro Series by Nova. As the field roll along the start and finish straight, when are we going to see the pin being pulled? When will we go racing? The answer is we go racing now, and away we go. It's a great start from Regan. Oliver Framuth, he has jumped up the order. Also well away is Frederik Blomstedt, and he is busy defending from Pavel Lefteroff as the field surge down towards the first turn. It's Framuth who takes the lead, or does he? Lefteroff darts to the inside. And it's Pavel Lefteroff, the Bulgarian driver, who takes the early advantage from Framuth. Then the pole sitter, Frederik Blomstedt, as they climb uphill. It's Luca Lorenzini in fourth place, or is that possibly third? He does battle with Blomstedt, goes around the outside of Frederik Blomstedt, and then Luca Magnoni down into fifth place. And are we going to see a repeat of Misano and Spa, with Pavel Lefteroff romping off into the distance, or will there be a bit more of a challenge from those behind? As the field run downhill out towards the furthest extremity of the circuit, this swooping downhill S-bend then takes them on to the double apex right-hander right at the foot of the circuit, and then the long climb round back uphill and towards the pits complex. And Lorenzini busy defending from Frederik Blomstedt. Blomstedt is going to have to make this move sooner rather than later, but Lorenzini, having absolutely none of it, defends, and that bottles the pack up behind him as they flick through the chicane and on towards the right hand hairpin. Again, defending well is Lorenzini, and just behind the black car of Frederik Blomstedt, we've got Luca Magnoni. Magnoni is poised, ready, waiting, seeing what's going to transpire in front of him. But Lefteroff and Framuth, as they have done several occasions already this year, beginning to build that little bit of a buffer at the front of the field. So around the hairpin they go, through to end the first lap of this 50-minute timed race. In yesterday's race, we got 25 laps in, no safety cars to speak of, and hopefully we're not going to have any safety car interventions in this final race of the year. So it's Lefteroff who leads, then Framuth, then Lorenzini from pole sitter Frederik Blomstedt, the man he shared the front row with, Luca Magnoni, and then Roberto Gentili and Gianluca Carboni doing battle. Japan Carboni having a big moment, very nearly having the car kicking out from underneath him. He did well, in fact, to gather that up as we are into the second lap of the race. There is Pavel Luftroff, our race leader, and you can already see the battle brewing for third place, and really Fredrik Blomstedt would like to clear this as quickly as possible. We had plenty of drama in the early stages of race one, where what we were seeing was jostling for position that was slowing them down, getting really quite intense, and it meant that the likes of Luca Magnoni deciding to just settle in and hold station rather than pushing any harder than absolutely needs to and risking the car. Where is this opening going to come from Fredrik Blomstedt? What you've got here in Mugello, as you can see, is lots of wide, inviting turns. Here is a look back at the start of the race, and initially Blomstedt defending from Pavel Luftroff, and Luftroff, the Bulgarian driver, doing a very, very bold job to dart to the inside of Oliver Freimuth. Blomstedt was trying to see if he could take advantage of that little hole as well before it closed up. He couldn't quite do it, and as a result, Blomstedt then demoted by Luca Lorenzini. Across the line we come then. This completes the second lap of the race. For my money, Oliver Freimuth a little bit closer to Pavel Luftroff. Luftroff not maybe gaining as much ground on this fight for third as we would have expected, as Blomstedt's got a good run here on Luca Lorenzini. Lorenzini moves across the inside line. He knows that Blomstedt's coming, then darts back across. Stout defence from Lorenzini. Now, can he get the car squared off through the apex? The answer is no, he can't. And that is the opening Fredrik Blomstedt needs. He darts through and snatches third place. Great move that from Blomstedt. They then run out a little bit wide over the curves. But now the question is whether or not Fredrik Blomstedt, the closest for this race, can set forth and chase down Pavel Luftroff and Oliver Freimuth. There are Luftroff and Freimuth out at the front of the field. Freimuth definitely closer to Pavel Luftroff. Freimuth, who was a perennial competitor in the Renault Mégane Trophy when that ran as part of the World Series by Renault, and continues to compete the car, even though that original base championship has been discontinued. Running in tandem behind Luftroff through the chicane. There in the background you can see Fredrik Blomstedt, who's already broken clear of Luca Lorenzini, who's under pressure from Luca Magnoni. And these early laps being reeled off very rapidly by both Luftroff and Freimuth. Certainly, you know, they will know that their big opportunity has come with these two or so laps that Blomstedt spent behind Lorenzini. There was the eventual pass. There was just no way the sky blue Ginetta could keep tight to the inside line. Meanwhile, this is about a little bit further down the order. It's Roberto Gentili and Gianluca Carboni do battle. Understandably, plenty to watch from the pit boxes, as it would appear as if Oliver Freimuth is possibly just beginning to contemplate launching a little bit of a challenge to Pavel Luftroff. Jinks to the inside, can't find a way through. Meanwhile, Luca Magnoni looks to the outside of Luca Lorenzini, and then draws alongside climbing uphill, but again, Magnoni's not got the track position. Lorenzini's got the inside line. Freddy holds it on the apex, which is exactly what he does. Then there is no way through for Magnoni, who runs out a little bit wide, almost kisses the gravel trap as the pair of them then run on, swooping downhill. This is battle for fourth place. You can see already in third place, Fredrik Blomstedt has checked out and is now off in pursuit of the leading duo. If you think back to Spa-Francorchamps, at the start of September, able to romp off into the distance. Not quite been able to do that on this occasion, but now it's Magnoni who is taking his turn to just wind up the heat on Lorenzini. Now, in terms of qualifying pace and single lap pace, you would expect to see Magnoni being that little bit quicker. But of course, the old adage in motorsport is, it's one thing to catch the car in front, it is quite another to find a way past it. And that is the exam question that is currently confronting Luca Magnoni, who looks to the outside of Luca Lorenzini. Can't find a way through there. What about into the next sequence of turns? Again, Magnoni shows to the inside, but because it's a nice sweeping entry, it means that Luca Lorenzini can get on the brakes as late and as deep as he wants. Now, in terms of the points situation, as I understand it, things stay as they are. Oliver Freimuth is going to be atop the points table and a series champion. So for Frederik Blomstedt, he has very much got the imperative to get the bit between his teeth and really start moving as leading duo. Already up into the chicane, the fight for fourth and fifth now flick their way through. We are into the fifth lap of the race, and it hasn't really settled down just yet. Now, this is intriguing, isn't it? We've got this fantastic fight for fourth. We've got a very close battle currently going on for third place as well, with Frederik Blomstedt really getting onto terms now with Oliver Freimuth. Meanwhile, Luca Magnoni, you can just see the poise of the orange Netta G55. Magnoni's beginning to run out of patience now. He can see his chance of a podium finish possibly begin to disappear up the road ahead of him. Looks one side, then the other, but again, it's Lorenzini's got the inside line, but this time Magnoni takes no stopping around the outside. Brilliant move that from Luca Magnoni. Nothing that Luca Lorenzini could do, and you can see why, because already Blomstedt is now asking all the right questions of Oliver Freimuth, darting and harrying the tail of the McGann. And certainly if Blomstedt can clear Freimuth, then Pavel Lefkerov is not that far up the road ahead of us. We're only at 20% race distance, still 40 minutes of racing remaining. We've still got 10 minutes as well until the pit window is opened. Here is another look from a different angle. Luca Magnoni to the outside. Brilliant, brilliant move. And just giving enough space to Lorenzini. Also making sure it's just a little bit tense for the sky blue Ginetta G50. Meanwhile, further back, Roberto Gentili, Gianluca Carboni continue battle, but again, Lorenzini so quick in a straight line down towards turn one. He's got the inside line. Magnoni doesn't want to give it to him. They're rubbing against each other, and Luca Magnoni's tipped into a spin. Around he goes. Such a shame there for Luca Magnoni. He's beached in the gravel trap. He just let the car roll back a little bit too far. He is going to require some recovery, and that is such a shame. He didn't need to defend quite as aggressively, but clearly he wanted to get out into some clear air and try and break away. Here is another look at it. Lorenzini to the inside. Magnoni closes the door. There's contact. It tips the orange Ginetta around. Right, now here is the fight for second place between Oliver Freimuth in the white and blue Renault Megane Trophy car, the black Ginetta G55 of Frederik Blomstedt. They have got Pavel Lefkerov just ahead of them. So the leading trio of cars, all very tightly bunched, but you can really get a sense that as Freimuth defends, it gives Lefkerov the opportunity just to open out a little bit of an advantage at the front of the field. They head through hairpin into another of these left-right sequences. It's almost unfair to call them chicanes. That's what they are to an extent, but they're just that bit more open, a little bit more attacking. The drivers can really see what they can gain through them, and then this downhill left-hand hairpin to conclude the lap. The exit speed is all important, because then they have got this ferociously fast start and finish straight. So across the line they come. Another lap reeled off now. What can Frederik Blomstedt do? Battle of a Freimuth. You can also see just how quick in a straight line the McGann of Freimuth is as he gets back onto terms with Pavel Lefkerov. In fact, he may even challenge Lefkerov into the first corner. Lefkerov doesn't have anything to do with it. The good news is that Luca Magnoni has been recovered out of the gravel trap, so Magnoni well outside the top six, of course. Lorenzini in fourth, Roberto Gentili in fifth, Gianluca Carboni in sixth place. And though that septet of cars, sextet of cars, are the ones that are really prominent at the front of the field, the rest of the pack behind a little bit more dispersed. Now for Frederik Blomstedt, he knows that he's got Marco Hillestangas to hand over to through the mid-race pit stop sequence, whereas both Oliver Freimuth and Pavel Leftroff will be going the whole distance single-handedly. What we've seen on a couple of occasions in 2015 is that Oliver Freimuth has been quite content, I wouldn't say to sandbag during the early stage of the race, but where we've seen him pulling the pin and really putting the hammer down has been in the stages after the pit stops. So the leading trio once more nice and close, and you just get the sense maybe that Frederik Blomstedt is pushing along Oliver Freimuth here. That means that Freimuth is getting ever closer to Pavel Leftroff, who hasn't been able to take advantage of the battle for second place going on behind him. That's also, as much as anything, a result of some very astute and smart driving from Oliver Freimuth. He's not defending any more than he absolutely has to, sticking to the core racing line, and therefore not slowing himself down unduly across the line. And this is where Freimuth can really take advantage. The McGann ferociously quick, and now he bursts out of the slipstream, looks to challenge Pavel Leftroff. Leftroff moves to defend. It's Freimuth who is able to dart past, though, along the start and finish straight on the brakes into turn one. Leftroff immediately looks to retaliate. He's got the inside line. Oliver Freimuth doesn't risk the McGann by closing the door. Tries to get a little bit more momentum climbing uphill into the first of the left and right flicks. Pair of them then continue to roll on their way. All the while, though, Frederik Blomstedt in third place, just continuing to watch and wait for the moment to pounce. And he might have his opportunity here, because running a little bit wide is Freimuth. Is that going to allow Blomstedt a challenge? No, it's not. Here's another look then at the fight for the lead, as Freimuth was clear into the braking zone. Pavel Leftroff as late as you dare on the brakes in the Lotus Evora. And that meant that there was absolutely nothing that Freimuth could do. And now, as this lap has unfolded through the mid-speed sections, that's where Leftroff is able to re-extend his advantage at the front of the field. It is where, more importantly, Frederik Blomstedt can apply the pressure to Oliver Freimuth, who makes the mistake coming out of the corner. Oh, he almost makes contact, does he, with Frederik Blomstedt as they run downhill into the hairpin. Good defensive driving there from Freimuth, though. He always made sure that he had got the superior track position. It means that Frederik Blomstedt is trying to find his way around a very wide Renault Megane. So the pair of them tiptoe through the chicane on towards the hairpin. Another lap about to be reeled off. And this time Blomstedt looks the inside into the hairpin. Great move from Frederik Blomstedt. Now, can he slow Freimuth sufficiently on the exit to prevent the German from fighting back? So across the line comes the race leader, Pavel Leftroff. He leads it from Frederik Blomstedt, but Blomstedt coming back under immediate pressure from Oliver Freimuth. Freimuth draws alongside Blomstedt. A repeat of the same move, really, on Leftroff from a lap ago. But this time around, Blomstedt, is he going to risk the car to the inside? Thinks about it. There's a space left by Freimuth, and that is enough for Frederik Blomstedt to sneak past. In terms of the points situation, I think as they still stand, that is good enough for Freimuth to take the crown, but it starts to get an awful lot more complicated if Frederik Blomstedt is able to find a way past Pavel Leftroff. Here's another look at the pass. No space really at all to the inside for Frederik Blomstedt, but he forces the move, and crucially what that does is it slows the car of Oliver Freimuth on the exit. So now Blomstedt, the bit between his teeth on a nicely rubbered in circuit, off in pursuit of our race leader, Pavel Leftroff, as we're only just a couple of minutes away from the mid-race pit window opening. That is certainly going to change the complexion of the race, particularly for Frederik Blomstedt, because he is the only driver in this leading trio who is not doing the whole of the race distance, as he now gets on to challenge Pavel Lefdrov. Lefdrov has to defend one side, then the other, almost leaves a car's width to the inside into the hairpin. But it's not quite enough, is it, to give Fredrik Blomstedt the chance to catapult through. But you can see Pavel Lefdrov moving off the racing line, trying to defend from Fredrik Blomstedt. Now, will Blomstedt make the same attempt as he did a lap ago? He's not close enough on this occasion. The Bulgarian, who leaves his braking nice and deep into the hairpin instead. Blomstedt looks to pick up throttle nice and early, and that might just give him a little bit of momentum along the start-finish straight. Somewhere there, behind the Lotus, is a Ginetta G55, but you can see just how close Fredrik Blomstedt is. He's almost pushing along the Evora, waiting for the last possible instant to duck out of the bubble. Which side will he go? He's forced to the outside by, again, some good, stout defensive driving by Pavel Lefdrov. Blomstedt looking for the traction all the way around the outside. He makes contact with the Evora. As they battle, it means that Oliver Freimuth is able to come right back into the fray. Lefdrov just having to deviate a little bit from his optimal racing line. That is exactly what Fredrik Blomstedt will have been trying to force. So they head downhill, and again, just defending, possibly a little bit more vigorously than Blomstedt would like. As Lefdrov here is a look. They came so close to contact. And at that sort of angle, it would have been very unpredictable as to whether or not both of the cars would possibly have risked being fired off into the tyre barrier. As it is, they are running in tandem, busy battling here at the front of the field. Again, Pavel Lefdrov just has to move right to the inside of the road. Fredrik Blomstedt can see space there, and you can get a sense of just how much the pace has slowed with this defensive drive from Pavel Lefdrov by the approach of Luca Lorenzini, who is there in fourth place, but appreciably closer than he was a few moments ago. And, well, the Euro Series by Nova has really saved the best for last, hasn't it? This is one of the finest battles for the lead of the race that we have seen all year long. A little bit of a problem there for Gianluca Carboni. Maybe he gets that stopped before the tyre wall. Indeed he does, only just. Actually very well gathered up through the gravel trap and finds the traction to the outside as the pit window is open. As we approach, we go past the 20 minutes in the race margin. It's going to be open for 10 minutes through until we are 30 minutes into the race. Now, when are these leaders going to take the opportunity to duck into the pits? There's certainly an argument for any of this leading trio possibly to peel into the pits at the end of this lap, just because they are slowing themselves down so much in this fight for the lead. It's allowing Luca Lorenzini to close up onto their tail. It's going to mean that anybody who does pit in and comes out into some clear air might be able to make a little bit of progress into the pit lane then for Gianluca Carboni. Very opposite timing for the pit lane to open, just as he needs to get the radiators cleared out, make sure that the car has not ingested any stones, as that's a good opportunity for Blomstedt. Looks to the inside. Lefdrov, this is the corner where Lefdrov spun out proceedings yesterday. Blomstedt again looking to challenge, as Mark Spakovos, who had a very brief race one, sits in the pit lane. We have got 28 and a half minutes remaining, almost at half race distance here in the final race of the season for the Euro Series by Nova in Mugello, and it has been a great race as again Blomstedt challenges Lefdrov and makes contact with Pavel Lefdrov. The pair of them running desperately closely to each other. You can see this is now a four-way fight for the lead. Luca Lorenzini has closed up as well. Lorenzini, who will be needing to hand over Stefano Stefanelli. Here's another look at it. And Fredrik Blomstedt, living a little bit dangerously by leaving himself exposed to the outside right. Into the pits has come Blomstedt. Also in is Oliver Freimuth. So Frederik Blomstedt will hand over to Marco Hellestangas. Oliver Freimuth won't be handing over to anybody. It's to a halt for Blomstedt. Hellestangas poised and ready to go. Swedish driver jumps out. The Finn hops in for Oliver Freimuth. There is inspection of the McGann to be undertaken. And now Pavel Lefterov has got his mirrors filled with Gianluca Carboni. It was Luca Lorenzini, but that mistake from Lorenzini, you just saw at the back of the picture, running out into the gravel trap, has rather disrupted his rhythm. Here's another look at it. Lorenzini just pushing too hard. In fact, doing very, very well, really, to recover it, because that could have been a slightly more substantial spin. Well, Pavel Lefterov has led since the start of the race, but it has always been a precarious looking lead, and this hasn't been anything like the two preceding weekends for the Bulgarian driver, who was so impressive when we saw him Spa-Francorchamps, likewise in Misano, where he was utterly dominant. Yesterday's race, it just appeared as if the team had possibly gone the wrong way with the setup of the Lotus Evora. It just looked twitchy, nervous and uncomfortable. Lefterov switches back through the chicane. Out to the pit lane comes Oliver Freimuth and Marco Hellestangas. They emerge in exactly the same order in which they entered it. So Marco Hellestangas, in fact, they don't merge in the order in which they entered, did they? Because it was Blomstedt who came in ahead of Oliver Freimuth. And so that means that Hellestangas has got to clear the McGann again as Pavel Lefterov rolls into the pit lane. Not sure whether Luca Lorenzini has also taken the opportunity to dive into the pits for his mandatory pit stop as Pavel Lefterov brings the Evora to a halt. Yes indeed, Stefano Stefanelli will be taking over from Luca Lorenzini on this occasion. We just saw the Ginetta flashing through the front of our picture. So these two cars now are racing the two static cars in the pit lane. Really, the ideal result would be for them to try and get the jump on Lefterov. We also saw in the pits there Salvador Tinio taking over from Roberto Gentili, as we are exactly a half race distance, and this has been a much better outlap for Marco Hellestangas relative to that of Oliver Freimuth. Hellestangas immediately snapping at the heels of the German, but for both of these cars the principal point of business is not to risk the car with a did not finish in the retirement. What they need to do is get to the flag in the best possible position, but an overly bold move will potentially cost them enormously, as now Pavel Lefterov rolls down the pit lane. Where is he going to emerge? I think he will come out in the lead of the race. As he applies the throttle now, gets back up to speed. And yes, in fact, he's going to emerge with a much, much bigger lead than he had pre-pit stops. We've also have had the change. Stefano Stefanelli goes into second place. And now Marco Hellestangas is up into third. So he, off-camera, has passed Oliver Freimuth. Now that could be very significant with a bearing on the points situation, because now there is a golden opportunity for Hellestangas to climb further still. Although Pavel Lefterov is some way up the road ahead of them. And already you can see the progress of Hellestangas closing up onto Stefano Stefanelli. There is the race leader, Pavel Lefterov, headlights ablaze, trying to set about building as much a buffer as he can. And certainly the conditions darkening here in Mugello. The weather forecast suggests that we probably won't be having rain, but nonetheless, you can see that Hellestangas looking to push very hard as Stefanelli just runs one wheel out over the curb. Now which side is Hellestangas going to go to? He looks to the inside into the hairpin. Stefanelli moves across, covers the line and defends just in time. The car then kicks out from the tail, almost presents the opening for Hellestangas, who again wants to challenge the inside, then looks to the outside line. Now, will he be able to allow the car to run on into the hairpin? No, he can't quite do it. Great driving from Stefano Stefanelli, who is doing an excellent job of really getting the car absolutely perfectly positioned. He's making, as a result, Marco Helles-Tangas do this the hard way. And is Helles-Tangas going to challenge the inside into the final hairpin? Yes, he does. Brakes desperately, desperately late. And through he goes. Helles-Tangas taking second place away from Stefano Stefanelli again. A very significant pass. It also now gives Helles-Tangas nothing but clear track to challenge Pavel Lefterov. But, and it is a big but, we have seen Stefanelli has been so quick in a straight line along this start and finish stretch through the first race. But nice positioning from Helles-Tangas. So I don't think there's going to be space here for Stefanelli to find a way through. Indeed, there isn't. So Helles-Tangas makes that move stick. Stefanelli immediately coming into the clutches as well of Oliver Freimuth as the pair of them head through the first of the switchback sequences up onto the tabletop, and then the road begins to fall away downhill. Freimuth setting about, looking really every opportunity to try and overhaul Stefano Stefanelli. All the while he can see Marco Helles-Tangas, his principal points rival, just beginning to ease off into distance. Here's another look then at the move from Helles-Tangas. Absolutely fantastically brave from the Finnish driver, and launching the move to the inside. Plenty to debrief from in the pits as we come towards the end of the pit window. It's going to be open for another minute or so. Stefano Stefanelli on the frame move, busy jostling and doing battle. The reason that it's showing as fourth and fifth is we've got one car yet to make its pit stop as through the hairpin, and again Stefanelli. As we saw in race one, the Ginetta G50s seem to get through their Michelin tires a little bit quicker than some of the other machinery, and it just begins to make them a bit more of a handful as we head towards the latter phases of the race. It's downhill through the hairpin, across the start and finish line, into a new lap. Marco Helles-Tangas appreciably closer, I would say, to the race leader Pavel Lefterov, and certainly Oliver Freimuth much, much closer to Stefano Stefanelli. But Stefanelli is a little bit of a demon on the brakes into turn one. It means that Freimuth's going to have to pick his moment carefully. Oliver Freimuth looks to the outside. He leaves it late. In fact, he leaves it too late. Runs out right to the edge of the circuit. Stefanelli sticking to the inside line. As we get confirmation that the pit lane has closed, we have got now nothing to get in the way of what's going to be a thrilling concluding stanza to this season of racing for the Euro Series by Nova. Two leaders closing up on each other, the fight for third and fourth also running in tandem. There you see the classification, the top four covered by just shy of 5 seconds. Then we've got Salvador Tinio a little bit lonely in fifth, Gianluca Carboni currently completing the top six runners. And the frustration here for Oliver Freimuth is that where he's had the advantage as a challenge from Helles-Tangas, can't quite overhaul Pavel Lefterov. But you can see that Helles-Tangas clearly is backing himself, feels he's got a much quicker car underneath him than that of the Bulgarian, and therefore will be keen to try and pick away past the Evora as soon as possible, and then set about building an insurmountable advantage over Oliver Freimuth. That is going to be the aspiration for Marco Helles-Tangas. At the same time, he doesn't want to repeat of all that, but more so with running offline and potentially coming into contact with something a little bit more solid. Another lap completed, and now Helles-Tangas really turning up the heat on Pavel Lefterov as the pair of them head towards the opening turn. Is Helles-Tangas close enough to challenge the Bulgarian? No, he's not. What about the fight going on for third and fourth? Well, Freimuth and Stefanelli still doing battle. Oliver Freimuth now ahead of Stefano Stefanelli. Stefanelli though looking to retaliate, looking to fight back, and it's now going to be through mid-speed corners where the agility of the Jetta G50 might just give Stefano Stefano the opportunity to challenge us again. Heather Stangast looking every which way to pressurise. Have a left off the Bulgarian, though would be well advised here to stick to the racing line. He doesn't quite do that. Preemptively moves across just a little bit to make sure that he defends from Heather Stangast. Now, as the pair of them battle, you can see at the end of that last lap, there wasn't a huge amount of ground gained on the fight for third and fourth. But now that Framuth is released, clear as definitely, that means they can't battle with quite the frosty they have been doing. Heather Stangast setting the fastest lap of the race a few moments ago as well. I think gives you an indication of just how hard he's pushing, but also just how quickly he was able to get onto terms with Pavel Lefdrov. Lefdrov will be willing the next 16 and a half minutes to pass by as quickly as possible as he runs a little bit wide through the hairpin. Fortunately, the next sequence of turns arrives very, very quickly, so the pair of them jink through that. And then to the inside now, challenging Mark Heather Stangast, and goes past Pavel Lefdrov. Great move from Heather Stangast. Lefdrov flings it sideways, looking to regain the ground. But that was absolutely beautifully judged by Heather Stangast. He takes the lead of the race. Although Pavel Lefdrov, headlights ablaze, has now got the advantage of the slipstream behind the Jetta driver as the pair of them head over the crest in the hill. Downhill. Oh, and that's a big moment for Pavel Lefdrov. That's a huge moment for Lefdrov, who goes flying off the road. And that's a big, big incident for Lefdrov. Very, very high speed. Unfortunately, the gravel trap does its job and stops him just before he has a very, very heavy impact with the barrier. And heart-stopping moments for Bolvato and Nova Race pit walls, because that very nearly was contact for Marco Heather Stangast. Here's another look then at Heather Stangast's move to take the lead of the race. To the inside of Pavel Lefdrov. Beautifully judged. Then Lefdrov fighting back, saw a gap to the inside, got the wheel on the grass, the traction broke away, and thereafter Lefdrov flying off the road at supremely high speed. And very, very fortunate that the gravel trap doing its job. Well, that is good news for Heather Stangast. It now means that he, with 50 minutes to go, is released into a lot of empty air. You can see the gap back behind it, all of the Framuth. I think, though, as things stand, that might still be enough to give Framuth the points victory. But now, really, the destiny of that is possibly outside the hands of Marco Heather Stangast, because Heather Stangast, he's in the lead of the race. There isn't an awful lot more that he can do than continue at the front of the pack. So a long start and finish straight. Across the line they come. And here is our race leader, Marco Heather Stangast. He will be hoping for a second half of the race, much as his co-driver Fredrik Blomstedt enjoyed during race one, which is one where he is constantly extending his lead at the front of the pack, but at the same time he's just able to drive within the margins of what the car is able to do. That said, using a little bit of curb, certainly pushing, and that's the key. He needs to maintain that rhythm. He can't afford to relax it too much, because that's when the mistakes do begin to creep in. Marco Heather Stangast, race leader, looking for the double victory here in Mugello for himself and Fredrik Blomstedt. This one, however, has been much more hardly fought than the opening race of the weekend. So we've got 13 minutes remaining. This is the fight then for now second and third place between Oliver Framuth and Stefano Stefanelli. And Stefanelli not allowing Freymuth to break clear at all. And then Salvador Tinio, there he is, right at the back of the shot, some 7.5 seconds adrift of this battle for second. But Tinio was very impressive in race one. He's got probably time here for 6 or 7 laps, Salvador Tinio, to close up on to this 5 second place. And it is a long lap here at Mugello, best part of 2 minutes for these cars to negotiate it. Stan Gass leading across the line. Then we've got Freymuth, and then Stefano Stefanini. Now, Oliver Freymuth has been affected a couple of occasions throughout 2015 with the odd mechanical issue. He will be desperately hoping to avoid that this time around. He exits the first turn without any problem, then just has a little bit of a dab on the brakes, make sure the car is settled for the left-right sequence, and then runs out over the curb before running downhill. The gap to Salvador Tinio is reasonably stable. Don't think that is going to be particularly alarming, as Stefanelli just about a second back from the Freymuth. The real difficulty of Fanno Stefanelli is that the points on the circuit where he is at his strongest is where Freymuth is at his best, and likewise where both of them are maybe struggling a little bit in comparison to some of the rivals. They're actually very evenly matched, so that is making for a slightly intriguing scrap between the pair of them. Here is the race leader, Marco Hellestangas. Hellestangas already coming to the end of the lap as he swings through the chicane just on to this final downhill left-hand hairpin. So we are about to approach the final 10 minutes of the race. Oh, and we've got another car in a little bit of trouble, and that is Pierluigi Veronese, or is it Giampiero Cristoni who's behind the wheel? It's Cristoni behind the wheel, and that unfortunately is it would so appear for the Ginetta. So a very disappointing way for them to end the season in the gravel trap and out of contention. So there are exactly 10 minutes left in the race. There is Salvador Tinio in the background. It'll be interesting to see when we next get a glance at the classification as to just what sort of progress Tinio is making. He and Roberto Gentili have been a very evenly matched driver pairing during the course of this weekend. And that remains the case, as there is Tinio, who is a little bit closer to Stefanelli than he was, only by a tenth of a second or two. That's not really going to be the sort of rate of capture that Salvador Tinio is going to be needing. But nonetheless, just there we see it, 7.2 seconds. It might just be enough for Salvador Tinio to reel in. If he can do it at the rate of a second a minute. The other factor, of course, that we saw yesterday is maybe one or two of the cars just beginning to run a little bit dry in the fuel department in the last couple of laps into the pit lanes, unfortunately, and looking like a new tyre for Gianluca Carboni. So a great shame for Carboni, who was on the podium in race one. And yeah, not sure whether the tyre failure was a result of that moment or the cause of it. Nonetheless, it has been enough to force Carboni into the pit lane and therefore effectively out of any contention. Not that he was particularly right at the front of the field anyway. Across the line for Hellestangas once more. There is Oliver Freymuth. Freymuth at a safe margin behind Hellestangas with some 4 or 5 laps left in the race. I don't think Hellestangas will be unduly worried. It's the Finnish driver just beginning to slide the car. There's the classification. Anders Dangas from Framworth, and then Stefanelli with Salvador Tinio again. A little bit closer to Stefano Stefanelli, so that gap is coming down. Yeah, I think the big question is going to be just how quickly can the gap be brought down. Well, here is Oliver Framuth. Framuth 3.2 seconds now clear of Stefano Stefanelli. So that is a, I think for Oliver Framuth, perfectly acceptable buffer. It now releases him probably a little bit more liberally than perhaps he had been doing a couple of laps ago, to see what he can do about trying to catch the car of Marco Hellestangas. So some more insight from the pit lane as for second and third opens out. Now where is Salvador Tinio? He's still a long way adrift of Stefano Stefanelli, so Stefanelli's third place is looking like it is going to remain safe, provided Stefanelli stays out of trouble, doesn't push too hard, doesn't run out of fuel. But you can see how much road Stefano Stefanelli likes using. It's one of the very nice things as well about this Mugello circuit is the very flat, low-lying curves. It means the drivers can really be aggressive in using all the curbing as across the line. Into another lap with just over 6 minutes remaining. I think we're going to have time for four more laps, including the one that they're on. It is going to be the time interval, isn't it, between Stefanelli and Salvador Tinio, which is going to be particularly fascinating. Oliver Framuth there in second place. In third place, Stefano Stefanelli. Pair of them chink through the chicane and downhill. Now Salvador Tinio, just shy of six seconds now adrift of Stefano Stefanelli. But again, in terms of distance on the track, it feels like that is an awfully large amount of ground for Salvador Tinio to make up. Well, there is second place car of Framuth. He is managing that advantage, Stefanelli, at about 3 seconds into this final 5 minutes of the race. It's not an awful lot Stefanelli can do about closing that back down. Through the chicane and then over the crest of the hill, downhill into this hairpin, which is such an enjoyable corner. The drivers can really attack it as it's a wide entry and then quite a late tightening apex for feeding them into the short chute into the chicane. Flick left, then right, and on to the downhill left-hand hairpin. Conclusion of another lap. Framuth and McGann takes the absolutely perfect racing line. Needs to get on throttle nice and early. He's not any closer to our race leader, Marco Hellestangas. Second place then for Framuth, third for Stefano Stefanelli. In fourth, you just see him at the back of the picture, is Salvador Tinio. Fractionally over 4 minutes on the clock. It's been an excellent season for the Euro Series by Nova, taking in some of Europe's finest circuits. Feels like a very long time since the year started back in April at Paul Ricard. Since then we've been to the Slovakia Ring, we've been to the Red Bull Ring, Spa-Francorchamps, Misano, and now here in Mugello, an absolutely perfect venue to bring the season to a conclusion. It's been a very close and competitive season, and Oliver Framuth has been one of the star drivers of the year. And he is a driver, certainly as it looks on the road at the moment, who is potentially going to be to the head of the points situation, although probably won't be able to anoint a champion until everybody is safely through post-race scrutineering. Mark Elstangos and Frederik Blomsten, well, they have done absolutely everything that they could have done this weekend. Victory in race one, looking very, very likely as if they're going to get victory in this second race as well. It's going to be two laps to go. Getting in and amongst a little bit of the traffic as well. It's not really what Marco Helles-Steinkaas will be wanting to see. It's just a potential distraction, a potential obstacle as well. He rolls downhill out of the hairpin, accelerates through on to start the penultimate lap of the race. He's not quite got enough time in his pocket to back off the tune of some 20 seconds or so, which would make this the final lap of the race. So he is going to do two more. He rolls down into the first corner. And that was such a scary moment earlier on, wasn't it, with Pavel Lefkov on the grass, very nearly spinning back and into the path of Marco Helles-Steinkaas, which would have caused a mighty incident and would have completely wrenched away any points chances for Helles-Steinkaas and Frederik Blomsten. Now they've got a little bit of traffic to contend with. And that is going to be the car of Kieran Gallagher. And Gallagher, well aware that Helles-Steinkaas is coming, moves smartly aside. And the next target is going to be Mark Spekervos, but Spekervos is well up the road, so I don't think that's going to be any particular concern. There is Luca Magnoni, and Magnoni having a big, big moment and firing off, and that is a terrible way for Luca Magnoni to finish the season. A huge accident against the tyre wall and such disappointment on the pit wall, the penultimate lap of the year, and that is the biggest incident that we've seen in the Euro Series by Nova so far in 2015. Here we see he gets on to the slippery curb and the car just darts across the gravel trap and crunches into the tyre wall. An awful lot of damage done to the front of the Ginetta G55, and that is hugely disappointing for Luca Magnoni. He's been one of the standout drivers of the season. That's what we wanted to see, though, is that Luca is uninjured, walking away. As heading down out of the final hairpin and to start the final lap of the season, it is Marco Helles-Steinkaas who leads over the start and finish line. Now, the clock is going to have ticked to zero by the time that he next gets around the track. And whilst this hasn't been quite as comfortable as yesterday's race, it has nonetheless been a very, very strong drive this from Marco Helles-Steinkaas and Frederik Blomsten. Blomsten, after being jumped at the start by both Oliver Framuth and Pavel Lefkov, having to fight his way back through a slightly slower pit stop for the pair of them, still leaving Helles-Steinkaas with a lot of work. He was able to pass Framuth and then reeled in Pavel Lefkov shortly after passing Lefkov. Lefkov making that mistake. Stefano Stefanelli is slipping into the clutches of Salvatore Tinio. Tinio is only 1.8 seconds back going into this last lap, so all is not lost just yet. Past the scene of Luca Magnoni's incident, and that is why Helles-Steinkaas backed off. He's now got just about a third of a lap remaining, so for Marco Helles-Steinkaas and Frederik Blomsten, in the way that Pavel Lefkov dominated the events in Spa and Misano, so it is going to be Blomsten and Helles-Steinkaas who have had the perfect weekend here in Mugello. Just a couple of corners remain as Helles-Steinkaas flicks it through the chicane on towards the final hairpin. He's got Mark Spekervos up the road ahead of him. I don't think that is going to be any concern now for Helles-Steinkaas, who just needs to safely navigate this final corner, which is exactly what he does as he accelerates downhill. The chequered flag is poised, ready and waiting. It's going to be victory in the final round of the Euro Series by Nova for 2015. For Frederik Blomsten and Marco Helles-Steinkaas, they take the chequered flag and victory. Second place will go the way of Oliver Framuth. But what about third? Because there, Salvatore Tinio has caught Stefano Stefanelli Framuth takes second, but is Tinio going to be able to get the jump here on Stefanelli as the pair of them run towards the line? The answer is that he can't quite do it. So third place goes to Stefanelli and Luca Lorenzini. Celebrations on the Nova Race pit wall. Absolutely perfect performance for Helle Steingass and Frederik Blomstedt. They take the win and they do the double here in Mugello. Now the roll back to victory lane for Helle Steingass and Blomstedt. They have the opportunity to celebrate, enjoy the applause of the marshals and the spectators here in Mugello. Absolutely emphatic and imperious performance. And this was one of the best races, I would say, of the season. Certainly plenty to celebrate for Stefano Stefanelli. Doggedly holding on through the final stages. And there is the very sad sight of Luca Mainoni's car being recovered from the tyre wall. Such a shame after Mainoni had been runner-up in yesterday's race, driven beautifully all year. He had that little spin early on in this race, was recovering up through the field, and then that heavy contact with the tyre wall. Very bitter way to end the year. Well, down pit lane towards Parfumé for our race winner, Helle Steingass. It was Blomstedt who drove the car through to the flag yesterday, so I'm sure that he will know exactly where to go to greet his co-driver in Parfumé as the car rolls to a halt. The door opens and the celebrations begin. Helle Steingass out of the car, number one. See, he sets about unclipping himself. Celebration for Helle Steingass and Frederik Blomstedt. They have comfortably won their class in the point standings as well. The ES class has been standout performers all year. Congratulations. Handshakes all around. Let's take a look then at the results. So it's the win for Marc Helle Steingass and Frederik Blomstedt. Second place to Oliver Framuth. Third, Stefano Stefanelli and Luca Lorenzini. Fourth, Roberto Gentili and Salvatore Tinio. Fifth, Mark Spakovos. And then it was Marcosini and Gallagher and Gianluca Carboni who made it to the flag. Luca Mainoni and Pavel Lefteroff both having big, scary moments. Cristoni and Veronese also finishing their race in the gravel trap. Helle Steingass and Blomstedt en route to the podium as we take a look back at the highlights of an excellent final race of the season. It was a fantastic getaway from Blomstedt. He was busy defending from Lefteroff, but it was Framuth who got the jump into the first turn, although Lefteroff emerged in the lead. This was the start of Luca Mainoni's disappointing day, busy battling with Luca Lorenzini. Eventually that battle got a little bit too close. It was Mainoni who was tipped into a spin, just beaching himself at the periphery of the gravel track. Frederik Blomstedt, having been shuffled down the field through the opening moments, was setting about recovering through the pack and was all over the tail of Pavel Lefteroff as we approached the mid-race pit sequence. Blomstedt got out. It was Helle Steingass who jumped in. Pavel Lefteroff, pitting a lap later, was able to emerge with a very healthy lead. That was a lead, however, that was quite rapidly chased down as a charging Helle Steingass wasted no time in dispatching Stefano Stefanelli and Oliver Framuth. It was then the turn of Pavel Lefteroff to defend from Helle Steingass. Very bold move into the final hairpin. It was enough to disrupt Lefteroff's rhythm. And as the pair of them then ran down towards the first turn, Lefteroff trying a little bit too hard, two wheels on the grass, the car pitching around in a violent and lurid spin that fortunately ends in the gravel trap and not the solid retaining wall. That was found, however, very late on by Luca Mainoni. A small mistake with a big punishment. Fortunately, Luca was uninjured. So it was a victory and the double here in Mugello for Marco Helle Steingass and Frederik Blomstedt. Second to Oliver Framuth. third to Luca Lorenzini and Stefano Stefanelli. So that is it for coverage of the Euro Series by Nova for 2015. Thank you very much for your company through the course of the season, and we will look forward to you joining us for the 2016 season, which, if it is anything like this year, it promises to be very, very exciting indeed. From then, from Mugello, it's goodbye from myself, Ben Evans.